this time of year, the forecasting business is at an all-time high. Everyone's got, you know, stock market projections and bond market projections or things to look out for in 2023. And that's fine. A lot of good contributors from a lot of sources. But based on probably the way I combine not just economics, but also geopolitics, bring them together. They've always been connected to some extent, but they've never been more interconnected, more merged than they are right now. If you're under 50, you've never seen some of the bear markets, you know, something like the Great Depression even 1987, the stock market dropped. It wasn't 22% in a week or a month or a year, it was one day. So if you're, you say, younger than a certain age, and it's way over 30, you've never seen anything like that. I've seen some of it, and I also read quite a bit of economic history. I wasn't around for the Great Depression. You have to be 100 years old to say you lived through that one, but I'm pretty familiar with it as well. But the one footnote I would drop is that you said people haven't seen these kind of market crashes. Well, not the Great Depression, that's for sure. But they have seen market crashes, but they've also seen it come back every single time. And that's what's different. So yeah, we got through 1998, we got through the dot-com crash, we got through 2008, we got through 2020 and COVID. There's actually a good size market drawdown in 2018 between October 1st, 2018, and Christmas Eve, what I call the Christmas Eve massacre. Stock markets dropped 20% in under 3 months when the Fed kept raising interest rates, even though the economy was weakening. So they have seen those, but every single time it came back, even in COVID, March, April, 2020, the stock market went down 30%. It did, I mean, just almost straight down. But by September, we were back to new all-time highs. And so it's not that they've never seen that kind of volatility, but they learned the wrong lesson, which is it always comes back. And we know why, because the Fed bails you out, the Fed floods the zone with money, the Fed talks it up, you know, et cetera. But the counterexample, 1929, when the stock market did crash, it was down 23% over 2 days. It was like an old 12% day and an 11% day in late October 1929. But it kept going. The stock market crashed in October 1929, but it bottomed in June 1932. That was a three-year moving crash or rolling crash, whatever you want to call it, with some rallies along the way. And the total damage was over 80%. Not 30%, not 40%, down 80%. And what people don't know, many people don't know, is you said, okay, you know, then it rallied in 1933 and 1934. The Fed messed up again and blundered again, as they usually do in 1937, and threw us into a double dip. But if you ask people, okay, well, everyone knows the stock market crashed in 1929. When did it regain those highs? How long did that take? The answer is 25 years. It was 1954 before the market recovered from 1929. Now, it doesn't mean there weren't gains along the way or you couldn't make money. You could. But if you say, oh, I'll just sit tight and wait till it comes back. Well, a lot of people didn't live long enough. They didn't live 20. They never saw their money back because they didn't live 25 more years. So that's a real bear market. It's happened before. And, you know, and so the point is you need to be prepared for things like that. And they're no one alive, but very few people alive have seen anything like that. So that's kind of, I think that's the right framework to put it in. And if you say, well, what if we had another market crash right now? We'll talk about reasons why in a second. Why couldn't the Fed just come right back in and, you know, print some more money and do the same thing over again and bail out the new failures, whoever they may be? You can just kind of keep bailing things out. Why not do it again? What's the big deal? Well, the answer is each bailout is bigger than the one before. And that's the point. You can go all the way back to 1994, Mexico, 1998, Russia, LTCM, 2000, dot-com, 2008, Lehman, 2020, pandemic. And they do bail out, but each one's bigger than the one before. I mean, we threw out $7 trillion of new debt on top of a $1 trillion a year baseline, $7 trillion in new debt to kind of dig our way out of 2020. So there is a limit. There comes a time it's like, hey, this bailout is going to be 20 trillion. You know, sorry, that's that check's too big. We're going to have to let some things fail. So what could happen? The first thing on my list is the China COVID situation. And by the way, the Chinese economy was in trouble anyway. The idea that China's robust and growing, too bad about the COVID, that's not true. And COVID's a disaster, humanitarian medical disaster. But China was suffering anyway because of too much debt, real estate collapse, decoupling from the US, technological lags, cutting off their ability to steal intellectual property, and a lot else besides. So China is probably going to have negative growth this year, maybe even negative growth next year. There's not going to be some great reopening. There's not if you're invested, get out. If you're not invested, don't go in because it's a disaster. So just to turn to the next thing I see in 2023 having a major impact on markets, I would say the situation in Ukraine. And there's a lot more there than just, there's obviously a war going on, clear, and Russia invaded Ukraine on February 24th, 2022. Now, the war is tragic, it's brutal. That's what war is. That's been going on for a while. But there is a financial economic war wrapped around the military kinetic war because the US, we've been supplying weapons to Ukraine and training and Poland. A lot of the so-called Ukrainian troops are actually Polish troops wearing Ukrainian army uniforms because so many of the Ukrainian troops have been killed. Various weapon systems are being supplied. There's a drone war going on. Iran's giving drones to Russia. The US has, its own drones. They're supplying them to Ukraine, et cetera. So that's been pretty well vetted. But the economic financial war around it, the US has put sanctions on Russia. The US, but also make it clear, the US and the EU and the UK and other allies have joined these sanctions against Russia, and they are unprecedented. And by the way, I spent a long part of my career working on sanctions. Financial warfare, exactly the kind of thing we're talking about now, is what I have done for over 10 years, longer actually, for the intelligence community. I worked on supporting intelligence support for the Committee on Foreign Investment in the US, which looks at deals where foreign companies are buying US companies. And you ask yourself, is there a national security threat here? It's not an antitrust review or securities law review. It's a national security review. And I used to do what we call collections, intelligence collections, to support that analysis. So we froze the reserves of the Central Bank of Russia. Completely unprecedented. We froze the reserves of oligarchs. We kicked the Russian banking system out of the international SWIFT message traffic system, where that's where big banks record large transfers to each other. It's kind of the nerve center, the beating heart, if you will, of the global financial system, based in Belgium. And Russia has been kicked out of that, and a lot else besides. Limits on Russian oil exports. Price caps on Russian oil, and so forth. And then Russia's retaliated. They've banned certain exports of strategic metals, fertilizer, grain, and other essential goods, to the rest of the world, or at least to countries that are participating in the U.S. sanctions. So I don't want to spend too much time going down the whole list. It's a long list, but the point is, it has been highly, highly disruptive to the food, to the supply chain, and the food chain. It's contributed to inflation, and it's getting worse.